During this session, we intend to cover that part in our career where we are settled but and ready to take the next step, the decisions, the many choices. What are the things that we should look out for? What's the mantra to grow? So we have our esteemed panelists who are going to share their experiences, their thoughts, maybe crack some codes for us, give us some answers. So let me introduce the panelists here. I have Sudha Nagarajan with me here. She's a senior manager at Brocade with over 15 years of experience in the industry. She's worked both in India and the US. She has over 7 years of management experience. She's seen both sides of the story, both being an IC and in the management. Currently, she's leading a team of engineers. And I have with me Malar, who's a software architect at CA Technologies India. She has a very interesting career history, which spans from being a teacher to a scientist at ISRO. She's been a project manager, again, seen very much every side of management, as well as currently she's in the IC role. She has over 19 years of experience in the industry. So having said that, a few housekeeping rules for questions. Please ask questions as they come up to you. And in addition to that, I'll also have a few minutes for questions after each theme. So how I want to cover this is we'll start the session with the what next theme, and then we'll move on to talk about how to grow in one's career. So just to get started, let me ask you this question. How many of you have gone through the what next phase? A thought on, you know, I'm there. What do I do next? Yeah, me too. And I've had it many times, not just once over 10 years, where I thought, I'm done. And what do I do next? It's been a lot of introspection. So let me ask you, Malar, over 19 years, what kind of introspection, how many times have you gone through that phase?
Every 2 years.
That sounds great.
So that's a kind of regular thing, but only once in my career, I was very happy for 5 years. I did not think about anything. And it was because at that time I was in government and the job was very, very interesting. So, but otherwise, I have been seeing this every 2 years coming up at regular intervals.
Okay. Sudha, how about you? What kind of introspections?
2 years seems to be a magic number here because the first time I faced the two was about 2 years into my career. I had started off in customer advocacy where my interaction was directly with customers, and about 2 years into that role, when I was doing fairly well there, but there was a sort of restlessness, is like, what else can I do? What more can I learn? And that's when the first thought came to me. So it was about 2 years into that.
It can really be a very confusing phase in one's career when you're thinking, and especially if you've given some time and you want to branch out to do something different. So since you're working with with a number of young individuals, what kind of advice do you give them when they want to, you know, branch out or think about doing different things?
So one thing to realize is, even though this is a very confusing stage of our life, especially if some of you are going through it for the first time, it's actually a very, very healthy sign, because it shows that you are setting your next set of goals and you're working towards your next set of goals. And to actually help you reach those goals, some amount of introspection is needed. So what has worked well for me, and I just got out of one more track, and what has worked well for many of CEOs and other folks, is actually writing up the pros and cons of the situation. First, try to figure out why you are looking at the what next. Is it some change in your personal life that's triggering it? Is it some change in your professional life? Are you in a comfort zone and you're not learning as much? So see what the trigger points are. Write down what you like about your job, write down what is not so great, and see how important the not so great parts are or these parts are. With relevance to this, there's a small episode that I would like to share with all of you, and that has guided me throughout my life. So this is something I read a few years back, and it's about a lecturer, professor of philosophy, who brings in a big empty jar into a class. he gets huge rocks, he gets pebbles, he has sand. Without a word to the whole class, he just keeps the jar on the table, puts in the rocks, and the rocks fill up the jar, and he asks, okay, is the jar full? And the answer is, yes. After that, he puts in the pebbles. The pebbles manage to find the space between the rocks and settle down there. He asks them, is it full? And they say yes again. And by now, they know what's coming next, right? He pours the sand in, and even that finds space. So the reason I'm mentioning this is, he is demonstrating this to help people figure out their priorities. So for each of you, while you're writing what you like and what you don't like, you have to prioritize and see what the rocks are, the most important things for you. It could be family, it could be, you know, learning technical stuff, it could be any of those. So it could be, it's different for every person. But you have to figure out what your rocks are, what your pebbles are, and what the sand is. And the other interesting thing that he brings out in this context is, if he had poured sand into the bottle in the first attempt itself, there'll be no space for the rocks and the pebbles. So it's very, very important that people actually learn the priorities, know what's important for you. And this could change based on life situation, where you are in your career, a lot of factors, maybe monetary, financial factors. It could keep changing, but it's very important you figure these aspects out before you decide what's working for you and what's not.
I think that was a very, very interesting anecdote. I think a lot of us can relate to that when we talk about priorities and when we are trying to prioritize things in our life. So Malar, you've moved many times in your career. You had many choices that you've made. What sort of introspection, what were the things that you took into account when you moved?
Okay, I'm sure there are someone in the audience, at least, I think almost all the audience must have gone through at least one jump, at least from company to company. And can someone tell me what motivated you? What was behind it? Yes, please. Company name and the brand. Any other? Yeah. Growth potential. Okay. Other questions? Yeah.
CTC.
CTC. Okay. Then? Yeah.
Change.
Change of culture, change of environment. Okay. You want to change the technology. Product-based company. Okay. Your dream. Management staff. So basically you had a little bit, you want a change basically. Okay, so there are plenty of reasons to do this, but there is, in spite of all the reasons, there is one common connecting factor. You are staying in the same industry. You are dealing with software, or you are in biotechnology, whichever industry you are in. When you move from one place to another, there's a connecting thread. And my connecting thread is software. When I was in academics, I was in computer science faculty. But that was not my choice, actually. It was offered to me, sort of, campus interview. They took the toppers and gave the offer. Then I took it. I was very happy. I got the job without having to attend an interview. Then my second job, that was my real dream. My college day dream is to work for a scientific R&D institution. And after getting into teaching job and earning for my for supporting myself, I started chasing my dream. And it took 4 years for me to get into that job. I got it. Then 8 peaceful years I spent in that job. But next, I was impacted from an external factor. The changing economic scenario of India, it was an external impact that had on me that pulled me out from scientific R&D and into the IT industry. But at all points, the connecting factor was software. I have passion for software. I am a technical person. At the same time, I can do management. I have a proven track. But wherever I go, the factor is software. My basic passion to do it better and better and better.
Malar, but you've moved. Sure.
When you look back, you can actually correlate certain things and say that these were the driving factors which made me get into a change or look for a change, right? But when you're looking forward, when especially when you are very settled in your current job and you like have the best of opportunities to learn the best of technology or work with it, how easy is it to change, you know? How easy is it to consider a change? Like, I find it very difficult to accept that I'm going to move to something next maybe at a later point in time. But what drives that is very crazy. For me, it's just change. I've just been with something for too long and I think that, okay, I should probably look for something else. But, you know, it's difficult to know if it is the right thing for me or not to make that change.
Yeah. There is all this management psychology textbooks tells you something, that there are persons naturally who are actively seeking for change, very adaptive to change, who are change aversion, who have aversion towards change. But our aversion is not for everyone, but change is, it's a risk. Change is a risk, basically, because you are losing some stronghold and then ending up into some unknown. It's not completely unknown, but there is a factor of unknown there. You are risking something. Everyone in my family was advising me against jumping from a government job to IT. That ISRO job, which I enjoyed very well, to IT. They said, you may not get into the culture of IT. You may not fit into that. And everyone was eagerly waiting for me to go back. But it did not happen because I had a strong pulling factor. So I know what I want. And I know, okay, this is what I want to achieve here. In my current job, I achieved the happiness, the satisfaction. And if there are alternatives where I can be more happy, then I could take. If there are no alternatives, for me there will be no way. Sometimes even if there's an opportunity knocks at your door for a change, someone is asking you, you head my establishment to establish in India, you head the Indian operations. Such an opportunity knocks your door, you may not be able to take because of so many other reasons. Not because of your confident nature or anything, but because of so many other factors. Probably you may have to relocate. At that point of time, it may not be feasible from your point. So the trade-offs, all that. So consider what is the return on investment you are going to get. So what makes you unhappy in the current position? Whether there are ways to rectify it. You can have lateral movement to other departments. There are all options. They were there for me in government also. There were offers for moving to, if you are sick with this job, why don't you take up something else? We know your things. So that option is very much there in the private industry. So consider all your options. You are, as software program writers, you are all very logical thinking people. Apply that logic in your daily life. Especially when you are taking decisions like taking a change. Return on investment. What are the disadvantages currently? What are the advantages currently? Put weightage to each. Order them according to your priorities. Then if you make a move, what are all the risks you face? What are all the advantages? What you expect? Whether that expectations will be met if you take the change or not. Do it. Take a paper and pen. Spend a few days on that, because the day invested is in you. You are investing in yourself. So do that very scientifically. It will be
Malar,
easy.
While we're doing that introspection, I think it's also important, I would say, to spend a definite amount of time in your current career before thinking about that shift. I think that's very important. And while you're thinking of a shift, I think it's very important to understand what are your strengths and hone those skills to move to whatever next step that you want to take. Sudha, you have young people working under you. What kind of certification and, you know, in honing the skills, what are the kind of advices do you give them, especially when it comes to, you know, moving to a different direction?
So actually I would like to add a couple of points to Malar's earlier discussion also before I move on into honing skills further. So one thing is, as mentioned, Ranjana was mentioning, it's very, very important for yourself to give that time. So let restlessness not be the main motivating factor for looking for a change. So there might be, say, a lean period within your project which is making you restless now. You know, I'm not learning as much now. Should I look out for something? So that's not always going to be the case. 2 months into it, 6 months into it, the whole scenario might change. So that, I would say, should not be the main motivating factor. So if all else is going well, hang in there. Because if you're learning, that's all matters. So, and I would say maybe give a year, at least a year and a half before you really make a big jump, unless the motivating factor is, it's a very strong trigger point, such as the company culture, it's something that can't change overnight and it's something that doesn't gel with the way you work, or you see absolutely no option of maybe moving laterally, things like that.
Have a mentor. Have a mentor inside your company or outside your company, so that you could talk this out with the mentor. They will be able to provide you solutions.
And while you're writing up your strengths, good inputs could be provided by mentors, your family members, and people that you work very closely with. Because sometimes there may be some strengths within you that you yourself might not realize. So you might think you're a very strong technical person, but someone else might realize that you have very good potential in interpersonal relationship, communication, time management, and so on, which would make you step back and evaluate and see what other options you could take instead of just basing it on your instinct. So this is something that I would encourage us to go talk to others. Now going on into Ranjana's point, look out and see how you can constantly improve your skills, because that is something that is highly marketable. So when you are looking for a change, those will really prove in very, very useful. It might be a different matter altogether that you might easily pick up on stuff. But if you have a certification to actually prove that you have done it, that is a very, very big plus for you when you're actually looking for a change. Malar, would you like to add something else to that?
Yeah, actually, sir, certification is the marketing factor. And when you are thinking of change also, it comes in handy. And you would have known, where if you have friends in banking sector, would have seen those who with MBA are highly paid. Those who are in the same desk for 20 years, 25 years, lifelong, they are paid very, very less. In banking industry, the ratio is very, very between a qualified MBA and underqualified person who is really excellent in that job is very, very different. So always, whenever you gain some skills, make it certified. And all companies are providing certifications. They sponsor your certification and all. So take every opportunity that boosts your skills. See, I came here today wearing this. This is my ITIL certification. After all these years, after 19 years, I thought I should do ITIL certification because it is necessary for my job, current job.
To move on, during the core area of confusion, I think.
Sure.
Slightly going back to the topic, you said about your changing profile. Changing profile, changing jobs, switching. I have a question wherein, you know, something might just strike my mind saying that, okay, I'm switching my profile maybe like in 2 years or 3 years, but isn't that like showing on my resume that I'm not committed? You know, because I'm switching at the same time, okay, fine, but I'm switching because there's a reason behind everything, every switch. I give that reason, but isn't that also proving that I'm not committed and also showing that, you know, I could switch this job also. Like I'm sitting on an interview desk and a person happens to ask me this, that, you know, you have a switching profile, that shows that you're not constant, you know.
There are 2 points about this. Number one, when we said every 2 years, this thought comes to...
I'm just taking a situation into consideration over here, okay. Not actually.
Okay, then
it's,
that
it's
is
a situation where I am sitting in an interview, okay, and I'm applying for a job. I have switched two companies so far in reality, but isn't that also, you know, showing on my profile that I'm not being loyal to the to any company as a matter of fact, and also I am switching jobs for whatsoever reason. Fine, I have a valid reason, but it's also showing that I'm not committed.
It is how you take that question and answer it. It is not if some the question is thrown to you focusing on commitment, why that word commitment in your answer? You try to sell yourself that by shifting companies, you have obtained higher qualifications or different kind of skills that will be suitable for this particular company. You have to focus on how to sell yourself. If you look at people at the top, I have seen equal amount of these people who are in the company, who have grown inside the company, who have shifted 11 companies in 8 years. I have two examples of this. Because the market is like that. But when they move from one company to another company, it is always growth like this, like this, like this. But after certain time, after those 11th company, I see that person working for 5 years continuously, and every time I meet him, I used to wonder. So how you want to handle that question? Selling yourself. There are a lot of tips available on the internet, how to take these questions and soft skills courses. You take, you will be able to take any question in the interview. Answering interview questions is different. You have to focus on the positive points. What kind of knowledge and skill you are going to bring to the new company. Companies don't care whether you are working for 20 years or 2 years. As long as you produce money now, that's sufficient for them.
A slightly different perspective from Mullers on this one. I think it's very important to actually put in roots for a while in any given place, because in addition to your technical skills, what you're actually bringing into a company is attitude and your aptitude to learn. And once you establish yourself, and that typically takes a while, it takes about 1.5 years for you to prove yourself, the things that you want will come easier in a way, in a place where you have established yourself versus a new place. So while in the short term it may be slightly more lucrative for you to actually jump after 1.5 years, in the longer term it benefits if you establish good relationships with various people, network with them, and that will actually help you gain a longer term advantage. So that's my perspective again.
Yeah, especially if the market is not going to, if yes. The market is changing, you will be forced to stay in one place. So be prepared for everything.
So I guess agree to disagree.
You see, okay. But if you look at it, I was with ISRO for 8 years. And in CA also, I'm here, this is my 8th year. So change, but inside CA I have taken changes. I was in storage, then into compliance. There are so many things. It is how you make your job interesting.
Yes.
And get a help of mentor. I strongly recommend that.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kanchan from Amazon. I have seen a couple of instances where people actually change, and when they go to a new company, after first or second month, they feel that this is not their domain or this, they are not suitable for that culture. So they realize it in the very initial stages. Then what do you suggest in that situation? Like they should move again after 2 months, or they should stay, like it's like killing their career.
I have myself been in that situation, so I can elaborate a little bit on that. That's why I think it's very important at the time that you're making the decision to take the time to evaluate and see what's working and what's not. And going back to one of the other suggestions that I gave a little earlier is don't jump into something just because you're restless at the moment. If things are working okay, just hang in there and other things will fall in place as long as you know what your rocks are. So yes, it's possible that the company culture, if you're used to a certain company culture and a certain way of working, that you might not do as well in a different culture. Even in this situation, I would say that some amount of time needs to be given for you to see what made you take that step in the first place. So go back, evaluate that. Was it the technology that pushed you to actually make the move in the first place? And if it was, why don't you learn a little bit, dig in a little deeper there, see if you can learn and spend some more time, give yourself time, one and a half years or so, and then decide if you have to really move on or move away from that situation.
And taking out emotions and thinking objectively helps you a lot.
Yes.
Like the moment you see something new, it is all new for you. You imagine how the first person on space would have felt. Now no one is there, you are taking off. That's why people are having fear of flying. Right? You are comfortable with something, but you have, you wanted this change and you accepted this change. Immediately don't try to react. Don't, one simple tip is, don't compare your current company with a previous company. Don't look back what you have lost. Try to understand the current company, understand the corporate structure, how people are. Then it will be easy for you to adapt to that culture. So it will take time, but immediately if you feel within 1 month or 2 months, I think it's an emotional reaction. What do you say, Sudha?
Absolutely, absolutely. Lots of questions, I think.
Okay. Lots of questions.
Sorry. All along we've been discussing about change which results out of restlessness or because you have better opportunities knocking your door. Is it unnatural to look for a change or think about what next when you're too comfortable with what you're doing?
That's absolutely true.
I actually belong to that category more than anything else. I work for Microsoft. I've been working for Microsoft for close to 6 years now. And I'm pretty settled in the kind of work that I do, obviously working with the best of technology, doing well in my career and growing really well. I'd want to believe that. But all this comfort actually makes me a little uncomfortable. And then it makes me believe that, am I really growing in that sense? That, you know, should I look for change just because I'm too comfortable in my current premise? It's not restlessness in the sense that I'm not getting the best to work with, or it's not because I have better opportunities knocking at my door, but it's just restlessness out of comfort.
I think the main trigger point for what next is when you stop learning. That's what I've realized is you feel you've stopped learning, and that's what you refer to as the comfort zone. That's when, I think definitely you have a point there. So it's not restless that you're bored, but rather that, okay, I've stopped learning at this point. What do I do next? How do I learn more? That's where it helps you to go back to your paper, see what your strengths are, where you have stopped learning, and how you can actually maybe utilize opportunities within your current organization to see how you can learn more. So these are the places where you go talk to your mentor, talk to your manager, say that I've stopped learning this, and I know that you have opportunities in these other areas. It might be maybe leading a project, it might be a different technology, it might be, you know, cross collaboration with some other team. It might be some other areas that you haven't explored before. So if you're in the category of people who need to be stimulated by a different experience at regular intervals, you probably want to do this exercise more periodically, maybe every 6 months or so, rather than every 2 years that we were talking about.
Find out a next peak to climb. That is what they call it in management literature, right? So you feel unchallenged. You feel too comfortable. Your flight has taken off and you are flying for hours. You want to land and rest, or you want to get into the next orbit. So that's a basic reason. So find something more challenging. That might come, that may be lying near you, on your desk, right in front of you. Take a problem and solve it. Or take a couple of weeks holiday, enjoy it, come back, you will suddenly miss your job.
That's true.
I think one of the core areas, you know, when you're working on the next area is, I found at least when you're in the 2 to 5 year range and you're trying to decide is whether one should succeed as an IC. The management track seems really glamorous. People are, and to everybody's credit, we're all good at multiple things. And it's very difficult to decide on, I think I would succeed as an IC and I would succeed as a manager. So which one do I take? And Sudha, you've been there on both ends. What would you suggest are the things, you know, which can help us segregate that, you know, these are my core strengths in either of the fields? I'm not propagating management or IC, but what does one look out for?
there are some questions you could probably ask yourself at that point of your career when you're deciding, should I continue down the technology line? I think most companies now do have parallel paths, whether it's technology or management. So it's no longer the old days where the only way to grow was to go up the management ladder. So there are a few questions that you could pose to yourself and see what you're better cut out for. One is, especially if you've worked as an individual contributor, as a technical person for a long time, are you comfortable having all your deliverables done by someone else? Are you willing to take the credit for it? Are you willing to take the blame for it? That is one of the primary challenges that a manager faces. And what I learn is, one other very, very important trait for a manager is he should be able to understand different types of personalities and how to actually help them develop further. And it's a very, very big responsibility that way. It's like, you're not, only by growing your people you can grow. And so are you comfortable doing that? Are you comfortable giving maybe negative feedback, what can be perceived as negative feedback to others? It could end up being, you know, someone you're really close friends with, but if you end up being their manager, you'll have to talk to them and help them grow in the areas that they need help in. One other aspect of management is decision making. Are you more comfortable if decisions are made for you? Are you more comfortable if someone comes and tells you, okay, this needs to be done by this date and this is how it should be done? If you work well like that, probably management isn't your cup of tea, because decisions have to be made very, very, very regularly when you're a manager. There is no pluses or minuses to either career progress. It's just what you're good at, what you feel comfortable doing, and where you feel you best fit. So these are some of the questions that occur to me. I mean, Malar might have some other questions.
Yeah, basically, most of us are first generation white collar job going women. That's a major factor I have seen. Because of that, our knowledge of how the corporate world operates is very less. So unknown always is a threat. The more you know and know, you will be able to take known decisions. Then that reduces the risk. So it is from my personal experience, I said, in my stage one of my career, when I was in academics, I didn't care about a career. I was very intent on getting a job in a scientific R&D institution. Then number two, second stage, when I was there, when I got my dream job, I was doing it, I was handling that managerial part. Management was also given to me, and I was doing it very wrongly. I was not working properly with my managers. I was a hardcore technical person, and whatever I do, tell it is right. And ended up in customers throwing notebook on your face, telling that's a dirty user interface you have designed. While I am thinking it's a beautiful, most beautiful one. They say it's a very inconvenient one. I don't like the color. It is not moving. All that kind of thing. I was not able to handle that situation very nicely. But in the third stage, I learnt it all. Now I learnt, I am a better, I have improved myself in that area. So now I learn to listen to people, take their, consider customer comes first, and whatever software, great software you make, big 500 feet tower you are building, it's not going to be of use unless the customer likes it. So I started designing based on the customer thing. So in these three stages, one thing I have noted is, in stage one, I did not have a management degree. In stage two, I was doing my MBA. In stage three, I have completed and had personal experiences also. During my learning period, I used to think interpersonal communication, soft skills, these are all crap. Even one of the professors said, this is crap for technical people. But I learned in a hard way. First-hand experience, I learned that these are all very helpful to project a professional image. These are part of profession. So know how corporations work, organization structure and all. So I strongly recommend you to try to understand how a multinational corporation operates. learn, take up some management degree. That will help you to take better decisions, and that will help you to be more professional, and that means growth. For growth, professionalism is very, very important. And these are all part of professionalism.
Hi, a question. My name is Lillian. I'm from Cisco Systems. So I've been an individual contributor working in tech for 11 years now. No restlessness. I had no thoughts of changing. But about 7 or 8 other people came and told me, you would be really good in a marketing role. So should I be listening to them? I wanted your thoughts.
That's a very a lot about what you know is your strength than about listening to anybody else. If you really think that's your strength, then you should work on that and probably take that advice. Sorry, Malar, you want to say something?
No, I was just going to think, because it's a very personalized question, we could take offline and we could discuss. That's why I recommend you have a mentor to whom you can raise these questions. This kind of conferences or meeting as happens very rarely. But with a mentor, you can definitely speak out these things and get a better perspective. So we'll take this question offline. If you want, I am ready to discuss. Tomorrow also I am available.
Great. I just wanted to add to that, because the same question actually came up in the senior management track that I just attended before stepping in here. And one of the CEOs of the companies there had a similar situation where she thought she was a hardcore engineer. And about 6 years into her profession, someone told her, you know, you're really good at marketing, engineering is not your forte. It took her a lot of introspection and inputs from others to actually figure that out. And she said she was glad she did it. Okay? So I'm not saying you should do it, but it is definitely, if other people think you're really good at something, it's worthwhile for you to go actually take a look at it and see, you know, do they have something there? Okay, well, maybe I'll shine better there than I'm doing here.
But especially if the person is ready to sponsor you. Really, if someone is telling you and they are really to support you in that new role, you should take it up.
I have one question. So earlier you mentioned about networking, right? How is networking going to help us in the career development?
I would like to just hold that off. We would be taking up networking and other things in a few minutes. So probably your questions will just get answered.
Okay.
So just to move on, I think the what next phase as such, and that's the theme we wanted to cover during this time. A lot of women go through many inflection points. There's marriage, there's kids and other areas when that's also one of the times when you think about what next. And a lot of women are not able to focus and think through that and drop off, you know, during this phase. So concentrating on the what next phase is extremely important, and the tips that probably Sudha and Malar you've shared are things that are to be thought about. But once thought through, there are very few women that I guess during the keynote we've already heard, there are very few women are there at the top ranks. And one of the key reasons is because they drop off at some juncture where they are confused, where there are other pressures that keep them occupied. But one other thing that is keenly observed is that women don't talk about their career aspirations as openly as men do in comparison. You need to understand your manager is not a mind reader. You have to go and openly communicate. So how many people actually come and communicate to you about their career aspirations?
And how many percentage of them are women, and how many of them are
Thank
men?
You, Malar.
Okay, my current team size is of about 35 people, of which, let me see, about 8 are women. And I think in my organization that my team has the most women is what I hear. So one thing I have to say is I have never seen this issue per se in women. So within my team, I've always found that women are very, very good at articulating their needs, what they are good at, and communication skills and time management skills are two things that seem to come very, very easily to women. So I think we should tap into those areas also, in addition to the technical areas, is time management and communication. somehow it comes very naturally to girls. And they do come and talk to me about their aspirations, and they actually have a very, very neatly planned roadmap ahead of them. It is true that there are various personal and other factors which could make them deviate a little bit from what they have set for themselves as a roadmap. However, one important thing to remember there is anything that we see as a hurdle is a very, very short-term one. I think all of us go through those phases. You've married and you know, suddenly a whole lot of domestic issues may come on your head and you want to know how to handle it. And but you have to view all of this as short-term and try to see ways in which you could address specific issues instead of letting your career you know, take the back seat at that point. So this is something that I would say regarding that. Maybe Malar has something more to add.
No, actually, as I said previously, this is most of the women are first generation women. And the average age is about 30 to 35, probably 2 years back it was 28, now probably. So it is too early to expect a lot of women CEOs in India. Not yet. Probably there are a lot of CEOs sitting here.
Yes.
It takes time.
It takes time.
Absolutely. So meanwhile, we conferences like this, meetings like this, we will train you, give you the confidence. We will discuss, we will form forums and plan it properly so that how we can create a lot of CEOs. We'll do that soon. I think that bargaining, how to, don't be afraid to talk about your career aspirations to your manager. Indian mentality is, for women, job comes second. But reality is, even for some men, jobs come second.
Okay.
So accept that fact, never give up, go and talk to your manager. Only that you need to put it in the proper terms. Because when they deal with men, they have a different kind of frequency. But when you go, for them also it is new having women employees. For most of them it is new. So you approach them, you strengthen your skills. Phrase, then discuss with your friends. Okay, what if he asks this question, how I will answer? So like that, take training courses. And then you will know how to take this up with your manager. It is not that women in India are not having career aspirations. All of you have career aspirations. But it is the problem is there are blocking factors. One of the factors is you are first generation. But you could definitely overcome with that, get a mentor again.
So one small tip on this is always keep the communication channels open right at the beginning. Don't wait for 2 years to pass before you're actually having an open discussion with your manager. Keep the communication channels open, talk to him, her about what you're doing well, what you're not doing well, what you're having trouble with, because mentor aside, your manager is somebody who could really help you develop. And no, you can't assume that they already know what you're doing and what you're good at. So just open up the communication channels very early on, as soon as you're in a new job, and that will help you when you really want to have these discussions.
During your evaluation cycles, make it very clear that where you are happy with all that, but where do you want to see you in the next cycle? Don't wait for 1 year, 2 year, where do you want to see in 1 year, 2 year? Don't talk like that. Where do you want to see you in the next cycle? And ask for his suggestions, what you can do to achieve that mark. So together, manager and yourself can plan your career.
I think another key area in moving up is networking, and which you were asking about. You know, how women can be better at networking. And another area that I would like you to cover is visibility. It's not very well defined to most people what visibility is and how to really reach there. So networking and visibility, I find, are very important items to grow up the ladder. What are your thoughts?
So Sudha, do because you hate networking?
Puts me in a spot here, but yes. Go
so
for
how
it.
How many of you line with Sudha? How many of you hate networking? Hate the word networking? Good. Me too.
I think we should all get together later.
Yeah, in which case, I think you should attend the networking session that's there.
That's right.
But I think that does not mean, but I am the person who is having a lot of networking. I mean, I have friends inside professional life, outside it, lot of friends. But I hate the word networking because it should come to you naturally. Networking does not mean you have to be part of n number of social networking site. It is not networking. I am member of only one site, the professional site, and I stick to that. I am active member in that. And whoever I accept invitations from and I invite are really, really professional relationship, very serious relationship. If I need some help, immediately I would be able to call them. If I need a recommendation, I should be able to give. And I accept people whom I could give recommendations. I could help them out. I could reach them out in case of emergency. I was in the planning committee of Grasshopper, and when we wanted to seek speakers, I could come up with a big list. And even I have people, in a single phone call, I could call someone from Bangalore and come and replace a speaker here. I have that kind of association with people. But I hate the word networking. I am not in Facebook. And I spend very little time on my phone. I hate my cell phone. I don't write SMSs. In all my life, probably less than 10 SMSs I would have sent. So that is different. Keeping the professional contacts is very important. You can do that, but don't mistake networking for being member of large networking site. At that point, you will never be able to manage your contacts, connections, everything will be, you will know a lot of faces, but you will not be able to approach one of them and collaborate with them or work with them, get help or provide help. Networking at that I could call, I think, safely networking at the extreme. Try to avoid that. But keep good professional contacts and personal contacts. That always helps. That's how I see it. Sudha, now you have changed? No.
One important point that I think is there is...
That's the question.
I think there was a question.
Just to add one second.
Please go.
One important point that is there is networking is not one way. It's not only for you to benefit from. It needs to be both ways. You should be willing to network to help somebody else as well. A lot of us don't have that thought in mind. We have networking in terms of just from a benefit point of view. So having that in mind, it'll give you the rewards as well when you require help, if you're out there to help others as well. Probably you could think of networking in that line as well. You had a question, sorry. Great.
Who asked you to be consistent performer for 5 consecutive years? Did your manager ask? Yeah, that's why you have to take it at a, that's where the visibility comes. When you are, it's a ego boosting thing. When you are rated as exceeded, far exceeded expectations, you feel yourself up. And you think that your manager has increased the bars high above you. Then you try to jump. Then you touch the bar easily. Then you think it is only your perception. Remember that awards, rewards, any rating comes to your current work. So don't think that that is setting the increasing the expectation from your manager. If you think and jump, okay, next time you will give, manager will keep on giving. You try once. You do consistent performance at that point, at that time also you will get exceeded expectations. So try to, don't, what's the right word? Don't burn yourself. Don't burn out yourself. What you are facing is burnout. So when something is given to you, when you get into limelight, it's very difficult. You always want that light on you. Know when to withdraw, when to get into that. That you
It's time for you to get promoted. I think that's what I'd say. You can have that question with your manager probably.
Yeah, that's why. Because you have been doing out of your own interest. And you have not made your manager aware that by doing this, you expect not just then exceed expectation, something else. So you, before doing, taking up any job, before deciding I will excel in this, you decide what I expect from that. What is my takeover for that? What is the compensation I expect from that? Is it just a pat on the back? Or is it a shield? Is it some percentage of increase? Is it a promotion? Think clearly and make known to your manager, I really appreciate what you have given to me. I have exceeded expectation. I will try to match your expectations in future. Just tell me what your expectations are for me to do next. And currently, whatever I have achieved, I am happy with that. But I want to see myself here. I expect this, 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 this next. Then the expectations are set from both sides. Manager knows what you expect. Then he will try to give you what you can. Then you can go on delivering yours. So make it known. Speak for yourself. Otherwise, you will face this burnout.
So, yeah, Sushma was just mentioning that it's not too good to grow too fast because every stage is important. So, I actually wanted to add to that. So, if you had exceeded expectations for 2 years in a row, it's likely you were promoted to the next grade level. And when that happens, the expectations increase, right? So, it's not, if everyone was exceeding expectations every 2 years and growing, right? People would be CEOs after 10 years of experience. It doesn't happen. So there is a certain degree of maturity which comes with experience. So you have to give yourself time to absorb that maturity that comes with experience. So don't push on yourself to always exceed expectations. This is a common question that actually comes to me from my teams. When I mark someone top or exceeded expectations, give them a promotion, and the next time they're just meeting expectations. And this is something I tell very clearly to them, that when you were exceeding expectations, you were performing at the next grade, therefore you got promoted. But in the next grade, you're just doing what is expected of you. And give yourself time to grow. It takes typically 3 to 5 years for you to actually mature to get to the next exceeding expectations level, okay?
Sure.
Established with your mentor. There are mentors who would support you in your career goals and in your personal growth. But it depends on the trust that you have established and how much you actually believe the person is going to keep this to himself, herself, or how much they are actually going to show it. So perhaps if you talk of some opportunity outside, you might feel, okay, my next cycle, they might ding me because they know I'm going to leave anyway, right? So it depends on the trust factor you have established, but it's not necessary that you have a mentor within your organization. So there is no better or worse. I think a mentor is someone who you really respect. And so whether that person happens to be within your organization or outside, I don't think you can really choose that. So it just happens that you really look up to that person and you want to emulate them and you want to learn from them. Both have their advantages. If you have a mentor within your organization, they probably know all your skills and will probably support you grow within. And if there's someone outside, they can probably provide unbiased viewpoints on certain aspects. It's good to have both, but multiple mentors may sometimes conflict with each other, so you might want to watch for that.
I have a last closing question I would say, and this is about a perception that's there in the industry, that women don't grab opportunities as quickly as men do. They have a cautious side to them. And that kind of holds them back from growing in their careers. I don't quite agree to it, but I'd like to hear what your thoughts are on it. Malar?
No, in my manager days, I have seen men, I will put the responsibility in a plate and give it to them. They'll not take. So it is not a cup. It's a common trend for both, but there will be when that grabbing hands come, and I see more men than women. And generally, when you offer something to a woman, if you see those who are in the same position for a long time, it's not quite glass ceiling. Glass ceiling is very, very above. But here also, there is a, in the lower band, when you grow over 10 years, you will feel a kind of resistance to grow further. It is far there for everyone, but there will be very few people who will filter out of that, and I would call that as a filter level. Filter out of that and grow up. And other people will stop at one level. For a long time, at least they will spend at that time. You would have watched men also do that. But when an opportunity is given to women, at least in the current scenario, it is given for very, 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 very strong reasons. Because they believe that you are 10 times at least better than your alternative. You will be shocked whether I will be able to do that. That's a natural human response. You should learn to accept responsibility. Or if you are having fear, talk to that person. Whoever is offering the responsibility, that means that person has trust in you, ready to support you, sponsor you. Then you said, yes, tell me what it is. Know more about that. Tell me more about the responsibilities. When I take this up, what is the expectation you set on me? And what kind of expectations you have on me? What kind of support you could provide to me? And take at least a couple of days time to think about it before answering. Don't immediately say no.
Okay.
Take a couple of times back. Speak with your well wishes and go back.
Sudha. Yes, I have this doubt. In your initial stages of your career, when you always want to achieve whatever your manager or your senior authorities have given to you, okay, sometimes when you think, okay, fine, these are the goals that my manager has given me, or these are the things that my higher authorities have asked me to do, what if you feel that, okay, fine, you know, I might not be able to do it? I mean, you have your own things, but your higher authorities feel, okay, maybe he or she can, you know, do that well. But then you feel that, okay, fine, you know, it's too much for me to handle. Whereas on the other side, you always have this, oh my God, okay, only when I finish this will I be able to actually prove myself here. But what if I'm not able to pull the string? What if I'm not? How do I even grow this? Do I take it up and say, okay, fine, I'll no matter what, I'll just take up the challenge, good or bad? What if I'm not able to achieve it? What if I'm not able to complete it? I mean, how do I do it? How do I face such a situation?
So I think the important point here is very important you have that confidence within yourself that you will be able to do it. However, there are at times unrealistic expectations that might be coming your way. So it might be because of some project pressures or schedules being pulled back or whatever the reasons. It's very, very important that you communicate to your manager about such concerns. Don't wait till the last minute before you drop the ball, because one thing managers hate is waiting at the last minute. So, you know, I'm in the position of a manager, I'm telling you. So make sure that you always keep your manager informed if you need help in any of the tasks that's been asked of you and if you feel it's unrealistic. But typically, the type of task that would come your way from a well-experienced manager would be something that you would be able to handle.
Thank you.
Hello. Yeah. Just to summarize the entire thing, so Sudha, what would you say are the three points that a person needs to keep in mind when they're going through the what next phase?
It's very important to set either short or long-term goals for yourself. long term, for most of us, we don't really see too much long term. 10 years down the road, who knows, an earthquake may hit us or whatever, right? You never know what's happening. Short term, we can see a little easier. So keep goals for yourself. Constantly evaluate your strengths. See how you can align it with your goals. And write up your pros and cons all the time. Keep track of that, and that will help you cross this what next barrier that you're facing.
And Malar, what would you say are the growing mantras, or the three mantras that you would suggest on growing in the career?
There's no mantra about it, but I could recommend three things. In the initial stages of your career, take certifications vigorously. And increase your qualifications, because qualifications will always take you, will be a factor in certain filtering conditions. That's number one. That's number two. When you grow in the initial years, up to 5 years probably, you will be on the job learning. You will be trying out different things. At that time, you need your manager to supervise you, give you orders, give you a job, assign you a job, supervise you, make sure that you deliver, and give you feedback that what you did well, what you did not do well, and all that. But when you move beyond 5 years, you are a technical person, it's a knowledge industry, and if you have seen the way the heads of Microsoft, Apple, HP, all they have come up, they are fundamentally technical people. They have written code. It's very rare in computer industry to have a CEO who has not written code. I think until now we have come across only one big person, and they are being hated. They are not very much included into the tech company CEO circles. Okay, so what you need to do is, at that point, what important is being a technical person. Once your technical skills are sharpened, you became an expert, your manager role changes. If it does not changes, it's a way you take. Don't expect manager to be your supervisor. Manager becomes an enabler. You have the ideas, you come up with business plans, you come up with ideas, and you gain the skill to present it, sell it to your manager and even the higher management. Then let your manager ask, and because he expects, hey, senior person, how I am going to order the senior person? All that. So I have only two mantras at the end. Perhaps forgot the third mantra you have? Suggestion? Okay.
I guess the only third mantra I have is, you should have your aspirations, be very clear about what you want, work towards what you like doing. I think that takes you to the top. Thank you so much, Sudha, Malar, for giving your thoughts, sharing your tips and your experiences. Thank you so much for joining the session, and I guess in the end I should introduce myself. I'm Ranjana Goswami, I'm with CA Technologies. I have over 10 years of experience. And I'm happy to have moderated this session. It was a great experience for me as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you, all of
us. You can catch up with both of them even after for your questions. Yeah.